This program was produced by Accuracy in Media, a media watchdog organization in Washington, D.C., representing the consumers of news.
As the 10th anniversary of the end of the Vietnam War approached, we began to see a new attitude towards the war and America's role in it. This new mood was symbolized by the completion of the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington, D.C., with the unveiling of this statue, portraying the men who fought and died in that far-off land as heroes. At the same time, this country experienced a new wave of patriotic sentiment. With it came a rejection of the notion that Vietnam was an ignoble war.
And we accomplish all of our missions, sir. We failed this country not one step. We never dropped a flag, nor did we ever turn our backs.
Soldiers of the Vietnam War met our nation's highest standards of service. The house-to-house battles for Hue, the murderous shellings absorbed at Khe Sanh, tested the courage of our soldiers no less than the battles of World War II in Korea.
After seeing the horrible consequences of communist rule in Indochina, the Holocaust in Cambodia, and the flight of the boat people from Vietnam, Americans came to recognize that this was a war we should have fought to win. Why didn't we? There's no single answer to that question, but many believe that our will to win was eroded by the way our media, especially television, reported the war. Hello, I'm Charlton Heston. Vietnam has been called the first television war because in the 1960s, television became our electronic window on the world, shaping perceptions of ordinary citizens and even affecting high-level foreign policy decisions. The war was never far away. It was right there in our living rooms, every night. In 1983, PBS, the Public Broadcasting Service, came forward with a 13-part television series on Vietnam. Neither the series nor the companion book by Stanley Carno fully explored the issue of media's involvement in the domestic turmoil that was Vietnam. When the PBS series about Vietnam was broadcast during the fall of 1983, those citizens concerned about the impact of media on American politics were gravely disappointed. Rather than coming forward with new insights, the series reiterated many of the same journalistic errors of the 1960s. Those who believe that the past must be recorded accurately so we can plan for the future dare not leave such a distorted report unchallenged. The focus of our program will be on the Tet Offensive of 1968, an event which marked a turning point in the Vietnam War. During the last days of January 1968, the Viet Cong launched a series of assaults on the major cities of Vietnam, including the national capital, Saigon. Communist planners assumed that local populations would rally to the Viet Cong and that the Army of South Vietnam would collapse. As the initial advantage of surprise waned, it became increasingly clear that neither assumption was justified. Civilians in the South did not rally to the communist banner. The Army of South Vietnam showed itself to be capable of sustained engagement with the enemy. Tet's two protracted battles at the Khe Sanh outpost and the city of Hue ended with huge communist losses. By early spring of 1968, the nationwide offensive was acknowledged to be a complete and utter disaster. In fact, Viet Cong units were so crushed that the remainder of the war was fought chiefly by regular forces from the north. But the real story of Tet never got to American audiences. Instead, by focusing exclusively on Tet's pyrotechnics, the American media, especially television, created a very negative impression. One of the most devastating media dramas during the Tet Offensive took place at the U.S. Embassy in Saigon. Sometime around 3 a.m. on January 31st, 1968, a squad of 19 Viet Cong infiltrators drove to the U.S. Embassy. They planted explosive charges against the wall surrounding the embassy grounds and blew a hole large enough to get through. During the opening moments of the assault, the Viet Cong commander was killed. From then until mid-morning, the fight for the embassy grounds was a losing situation for the attackers. Although major media reported otherwise, at no time did the Viet Cong get into the embassy building. It was all over by 11 a.m. Ambassador Bunker was at his desk by noon. Keeping these vital facts in mind, let's see some representative media reports from the embassy.
Snipers are in the building and on rooftops near the embassy and are firing on American personnel inside the compound. 20 suicide commandos are reported to be holding the first floor of the embassy, and some were still there toward daybreak.
26 men break a hole in the wall of the American embassy compound, and they don't get past three Marines on the door. There were only three Marines guarding the American embassy at the outset. They didn't get past those three Marines. But it was reported by networks that they had broken into the embassy. They were on the third floor, they were on the eighth floor, and there was never retractions.
Communist commandos penetrated the supposedly attack-proof building in the climax of a combined artillery and guerrilla assault that brought limited warfare to Saigon itself. Associated Press photographer Dan Van Falk, who got inside the building, reported bodies were strewn around the rooms. He said the Viet Cong wore gray uniforms with cartridge belts and that some had red armbands.
They got into the yard, but they didn't get any further. They did not get into the embassy building, but this was reported on American television, despite the fact that when I arrived on the scene, as the last Viet Cong was in the process of being disposed of. I went in the building, I went to the top and walked through every floor. I came down and on the embassy grounds I held a press conference and said I had just been through the building, I had just talked to Washington, given them a report, and that there was no enemy in the building and none had entered the embassy building.
George MacArthur was a correspondent in Vietnam during Tet.
It had become a symbol of the American presence in Saigon. In conjunction with the adversarial relationship that had been created by the press, and the fact that a goodly number of the newspaper men there literally detested the American authority figure, if you will, and it was symbolized in that building. They were conditioned by their adversarial relationship with the military to believe the worst. And when the worst happened to that which was the symbol, then the temptation, as we say in the newspaper business, to take it and run was too great for many to resist. And within that next 4 or 5 hours, our defeat was recorded for the whole world to see and rejoice in. It was untrue, but the damage had been done, and you can't catch things like that.
Well, at the time of the Tet Offensive, I was the director of information at the Embassy of Vietnam here in Washington. And because of that, the function of mine, I had a very good vantage point. After 48 hours, the whole thing becomes very clear. That is, the communists have been thrown out of the major point of attacks. And there's only a couple of cities where there was still fighting going on.
In his monumental study of Tet reporting, Peter Braestrup reminds us, Hanoi didn't claim a victory, psychological, symbolic, or otherwise, at the embassy. But American newsmen were quick to award Hanoi a major psychological triumph there. Robert Elegant is an award-winning journalist who covered the war for the Los Angeles Times. He's written with insight about Vietnam and media.
1981, I published an article entitled How to Lose a War in a rather obscure British intellectual magazine called Encounter. I wrote about Vietnam and I said that for the first time in history, the outcome of a major conflict was determined not on the battlefield nor in the negotiating chambers, but on the printed page and the television screen.
Trong Nhu Tang was once the Viet Cong Minister of Justice. Now he lives in exile from communist tyranny.
We lost a lot of fighters.
Nous avons cinq divisions.
We had five divisions, the first, the third, the fifth, seventh, and ninth.
Mais après l'offensive du Tet, toutes ces divisions n'ont plus que.
But after the Tet offensive, all these divisions ended up with not even half of their forces.
Au point de vue militaire, je crois que les Américains n'ont pas soupé de fortes pertes humaines.
From the military point of view, I believe that the Americans at Tet did not sustain great losses of human lives.
C'est un coup très dur.
But from the political point of view, it was a very heavy blow for President Johnson's government.
Cela a permis au mouvement anti-guerre américain de.
The loss made the American anti-war movement exert pressure on the American government.
Donc, nous gagnons ce que nous perdons sur le plan militaire, nous gagnons sur le plan diplomatique et psychologique.
So what we lost on the military front, we won on the diplomatic and psychological fronts. Above all, on the fourth front, the mass media, the press, television, and the liberals in the United States.
Les libéraux aux États-Unis.
Walter Cronkite, in a post-Tet special on February 27, 1968, announced that Tet proved we were mired in stalemate and urged that America negotiate and withdraw as soon as possible. As honorable people who did the best they could. With such an authority figure turning away from the struggle, it's no wonder that his pessimism found willing believers. But the embassy story was only the opening chapter of Tet, even though, as Braestrup observes, it was indeed a portent of journalistic reactions to come. The Battle for Khe Sanh was one of the more newsworthy stories of the Tet Offensive, and like Tet itself, a place where ultimately successful Allied efforts were transformed by the camera's eye into images of defeat. In this section of television's Vietnam, we'll contrast the perceptions of the troops on the battle scene with the television and photo reports that were sent back to American audiences. Because the battle came as a surprise to reporters, they assumed that Tet attacks on Khe Sanh in January 1968 found the Marines equally unprepared. Actually, fighting in the Khe Sanh area had been going on since April of 1967. Unlike the press, Marine officers at the base knew very well what the enemy planned.
During the siege, I had an unusual experience in that I had extended my tour in Vietnam for 6 months, and as a result, was entitled to a 30-day leave. This leave came right in the middle of the siege. I left Khe Sanh on February 15th, and returned to Khe Sanh just before the siege concluded. This gave me an opportunity to participate in the siege at Khe Sanh, go home, watch it on television for a while, and then go back into Khe Sanh. When I was home on leave, I encountered several myths concerning the Battle of Khe Sanh. The myth that impressed me the most was everyone I met seemed to believe that the Marines were caught totally surprised on January 21st of 1968. That was definitely not true.
The Khe Sanh Combat Base was a massively fortified artillery base and an airstrip defended by some 6,000 U.S. Marines. It was carved into the face of a plateau in the northwest corner of the Republic of South Vietnam, some 16 kilometers east of Laos and 25 kilometers south of the Demilitarized Zone, which separated North Vietnam from South Vietnam. Because it was within such easy striking range of these two key communist sanctuaries and staging areas, it quickly became a major thorn in the side of the North Vietnamese. They decided, by late 1967, to eliminate it by simply overrunning it with massively superior forces. They failed to recognize, however, the resolution and the resources that would be brought to the fight by the Americans.
As the Tet Offensive continued to make news, press reports about Khe Sanh stressed imminent disaster. Lack of knowledge about U.S. military capabilities in the Khe Sanh area and ignorance of enemy intentions didn't prevent correspondents from using specific images as microcosms of military bumbling. Drama attracts the camera's eye. And after January 21st, television was fascinated with Khe Sanh as the ammo dump exploded, fires burned, and a few large planes were destroyed. TV loves fires.
This is one place where the Americans cannot claim they have the initiative in Vietnam. Here, the North Vietnamese decide who lives and who dies. Every day, which planes land and which ones don't. And sooner or later, they will make the move that will seal the fate of Khe Sanh.
From the North Vietnamese point of view, Khe Sanh is an easy target for its mortars and rockets, a convenient place to bleed the Marines, and what may be most crucial, tie down and isolate 6,000 American troops and about 20,000 reserves far from the protective coastal plain. For 20 years, General Giap has used the same tactics.
Since its usefulness as a roadblock and a forward base has been so vastly diminished, it can be assumed that Khe Sanh now is mostly a symbol. But of what? Pride, morale, bravery, or administration intransigence and military miscalculation?
When a plane does land, much of the activity stops while everyone watches to see if the plane makes it. This is all that's left of a C-130 that landed loaded with gasoline. Some inside escaped, others did not. This is the residue of a CH-53 helicopter, the biggest the Marines have. About the time this is being filmed, another helicopter was being shot down just a few miles from Khe Sanh, killing all 22 Americans on board.
When enemy fire comes in, the guys run for it. When planes come in, they try to shoot a landing so fast the enemy gunners can't knock them down with either rockets or machine gun fire. The big C-130s sometimes make it. Sometimes they don't.
That often viewed C-130, which was near Khe Sanh and which was shot down when we were still using the airfield there, was a very dramatic backdrop for commentators to get up and tell their story of gloom and doom. The American people, of course, received the impression, quite understandably, the C-130s have been shot down all over the place. But frankly, this was the only C-130 that was available there and that was shot down during the, in the environs of the Khe Sanh airfield.
TV likes fires. The joke in Vietnam was that if there's smoke in the picture, I can sell it. TV, which is kind of a inadequate information medium because it cannot handle complexity. And the simplistic story of Tet was disaster. The great thing about Khe Sanh was that it served journalistic ends, especially television. There were only four American planes shot down during the siege, but they were all easy to photograph. They looked terrific on film. And TV journalists could fly into Khe Sanh, do a stand-upper in front of the same wrecked aircraft and say things like, here we have a graveyard of twisted airplanes. You could have, as a CBS correspondent said, the sense of doom. Famous stand-upper, I think in front of the same graveyard of airplanes, the four planes that were shot down. You could have a CBS correspondent stand up and say, very early in the siege, the North Vietnamese determine who lives or dies at Khe Sanh. Obviously, if the North Vietnamese had had their druthers, there would have been nobody left alive at Khe Sanh. And our casualties were very low. The whole thing was a kind of television melodrama, and it was predictable. It was something you could count on. It was surefire, and they exploited it to the hilt.
While the siege was still on, newsmen claimed many links between the battle for Khe Sanh and an earlier symbolic battle, links which could only enhance a portrait of defeat. In 1954, General Vo Nguyen Giap and his forces surrounded the French base and eventually overran it. This symbolic victory turned French public opinion against the war. The devastation at Khe Sanh, plus the fact that the base was encircled by superior numbers of enemy troops, reminded many in both press and government of the French debacle. Bernard Fall's narrative history of the French defeat at Dien Bien Phu, entitled Hell in a Very Small Place, became required reading for correspondents flying up to Khe Sanh. As a result, it's not surprising that reporters who stayed for no more than a day or two, said that the battle looked like a rerun of the French disaster. Here, ABC's Bob Young makes the Dien Bien Phu analogy. Walter Cronkite added his contributions to gloomy Dien Bien Phu predictions. Although there were no facts to substantiate the claim, the American people were told by Walter Cronkite and others that the victorious general of Dien Bien Phu was again in charge. File photos like this one of General Giap were aired. Time magazine ran this cover portrait of the North Vietnamese general. In contrast, Newsweek proclaimed General William Westmoreland as the man on the spot. The supposed lessons of the past made for dramatic reporting. Images of past and present seemed to merge. In Vietnam, the differences between the two battles seemed more vivid than their similarities.
The main differences between Dien Bien Phu and Khe Sanh were that the U.S. Marines always maintained control of the high ground surrounding their base. They were able to resupply their forces at the garrison, relying exclusively on aerial transport. They had access to artillery support from U.S. bases at nearby Camp Carroll and the Rock Pile. And most importantly, they had crucial tactical air support, which really broke the backs of the North Vietnamese surrounding them.
On March 18th, over 2 weeks after the tide of battle had been turned by the Marines at Khe Sanh, Newsweek joined Walter Cronkite, David Douglas Duncan, and other media spokesmen in making specific images from the Khe Sanh experience symbolic of the entire war effort. Few readers would understand that the dramatic cover photo had been taken 2 months earlier, on the exciting day when the ammo dump was hit. Images, images. To see is to believe, but in whose context?
Though the U.S. dilemma at Khe Sanh is particularly acute, it is not unique. It simply reflects in microcosm the entire U.S. military position in Vietnam. U.S. strategy in Vietnam up to this point has been a failure.
I noticed a copy of Newsweek with a cover story on the siege at Khe Sanh. I went over and immediately bought a copy of it and proceeded to read it. And it was very disturbing.
William Jayne, who fought in the battle for over 3 months, had his own encounter with Newsweek.
And my parents had saved the famous Newsweek issue, The Agony of Khe Sanh, I believe it was a March 18th issue. And I was somewhat confused by their treatment of it, the theatricality, the drama, the kind of negativism that was obvious in the whole article, The Agony of Khe Sanh, the pictures of Marines only in kind of defensive postures and cowering and that sort of stuff in the trenches. So we took, although we got a lot of incoming rounds, rockets and artillery especially, down by the airstrip, the North Vietnamese never mounted a determined ground assault against us. There is no doubt in my mind that by any kind of definition, we won the battle.
From 21 January to 15 April 1968, U.S. forces at Khe Sanh suffered 199 men killed in action and about 1,600 wounded in action. During the same period, their North Vietnamese adversaries suffered between 9 and 14,000 killed in action. U.S. forces during the Khe Sanh siege fired in excess of 150,000 artillery rounds against enemy positions, and U.S. aircraft dropped in excess of 100,000 tons of bombs in the aptly named Operation Niagara on North Vietnamese positions around Khe Sanh.
During the Tet Offensive, the Viet Cong attacked almost every major city in Vietnam. They expected the city dwellers to rise up and support them. That didn't happen. The communist attackers were repulsed with heavy losses. They did succeed in holding one city for 25 days, the old imperial capital of Hue, not far from the North Vietnamese border. Dolph Droege, who was serving in the staff of the National Security Council at the time, describes what happened.
They then carried out their political program. They had a clipboard type of listing of people and ask them to come to political re-education courses or political orientation courses, sort of to give them the message on what the revolution is all about. And so many families bid goodbye to members of their family going out to these courses for a brief time, and they never returned. And when you come to the, after the removal of the North Vietnamese from the city, U.S. Marines, the U.S. troops, and the South Vietnamese troops liberated the city. Then these people, 5,000, were missing. Sometime around May, a farmer in the ravines outside the city stumbled on a piece of wire sticking out of the ground. And as you would do in that kind of thing, you kind of kick at it because it's almost grabbed your sandal. And you kick it loose, but it comes up out of the ground and a hand, a skeleton-like hand, comes with it. And that was the beginning of the discovery of the bodies. And then the people went out from the city to see where those missing people might have gone. And there the identifications were made and the mass graves were found. And probably by the figures there, 3,000 people, perhaps more, were buried alive, shot in the back of the head or strangled, and they had their hands tied, many times with wire, behind their back. That was the scene.
Now, you'd have thought that this would be a major story. That year of 1968, the New York Times carried only 4 stories, all told about it. In a 2-year period, they carried a total of 8 stories. According to Peter Braestrup in his book, Big Story, the records indicate that it was never reported on American television at all.
PBS's treatment of the Hue massacre repeats the journalistic distortion of the 1960s by allowing a communist spokesman to explain away the event.
The people so hated those who had tortured them in the past that when the revolution came to Hue, they rooted out those despots to get rid of them, just as they would poisonous snakes who, if allowed to live, would commit further crimes. And so, even though our policy was to re-educate and never kill anyone who surrendered to us, the people of the city took justice into their own hands. And there was little our revolutionary commanders could do to control them while the fighting raged.
Well, the PBS series, in their presentation of the Hue massacre, put Hoàng Phủ Ngọc Tường on the screen to explain about what happened in Hue during that time. Now, Hoàng Phủ Ngọc Tường was the head of the Communist Infiltration Network among the student population in Hue at the Hue University. He was, in fact, the one running the so-called revolutionary government in Hue during the 3 weeks that the communists were there. He was probably the one to order the execution of these at least 4,000 people that we discovered later in mass graves. Now, years later, he's allowed to explain about what happened in Hue. Now, it's about equivalent to Himmler talking about a concentration camp.
I've had the opportunity to uncover many a mass grave where the Viet Cong had buried a number of Vietnamese during the Tet attacks. Because I had the task of locating the bodies of 2 priests in my denomination who had been captured and buried alive. After a search lasting many days, I located their bodies. They had been buried in a sitting position. I can say that they had been buried alive. One of the priests had a broken skull. The other did not show any signs of such treatment. Not only was I at the graves, but I had held those crushed skulls in my hands and those arms still hanging by the flesh. And I also brought up the bones from the graves and carried them to the funeral chambers. Each chamber was about 10 meters long and 4 meters deep. Within 10 days, 3 such houses were filled with corpses.
I reported on the Hue massacre. Oddly enough, I was, I think, the first or among the very first to report on it, because I trusted my sources. Most of my colleagues appear to have not been interested in reporting on it, and I think there was a psychological disinclination to accept its existence.
In November of 1969, the American media broadcast a grim story from My Lai. Is there anyone who hasn't heard of the My Lai massacre? It happened when American troops, under the command of Lieutenant William Calley, attacked a village they believed harbored Viet Cong.
You have to understand that the American troops involved in the My Lai incident were really quite green. They hadn't tied into significant combat with enemy forces, but they were continually being harassed, wounded, and killed by booby traps and landmines. Now, when they finally went into the My Lai village complex, they were frustrated, bitter, angry, and really straining at the bit. It took a combination of incompetent leadership, overzealous performance of perceived duty, and a crowd mentality that took over the individual soldiers to result in the deaths of some several hundred apparently innocent civilian noncombatants. But we must remember that these killings were neither authorized nor legal, nor for that matter intended. This was a tragic accident of war.
As I travel around the country speaking, I frequently ask audiences, how many people here have ever heard of the Hue massacre? And usually you will find one, two, or maybe three people out of 100 that will raise their hands, which shows how little impression this made upon the people as a result of the way in which it was not reported by our media. If, on the other hand, you ask an audience, and this includes even student audiences today, how many people here have not heard of the My Lai massacre, you will very rarely find anyone who will raise his hand and admit that he has not heard of that event. The contrast is striking. It shows how forcibly the atrocity by the American troops was impressed upon the public and how it has been continued down to the present time, passed on to even young people who were not even conscious of these events at the time they occurred.
To television viewers, the greatest atrocity of the war was probably the coverage of a single death in Saigon during the Tet street fighting. This dramatic picture of one man's death certainly aroused journalistic attention. And a brutal moment in time, it was etched in the public mind with an Allied official, Nguyen Ngoc Loan, pulling the trigger. The Loan story was part of the street fighting in Saigon. Let's look at a recreation of the NBC report of the Loan incident as it appeared in the Huntley-Brinkley report.
The Viet Cong were working their way to the An Quang Pagoda. They were undoubtedly Viet Cong sympathizers. Government troops have captured the commander of the Viet Cong command unit. He was roughed up badly but refused to talk. A South Vietnamese officer held a paper taken from the enemy officer. The chief of South Vietnam's National Police, Nguyen Ngoc Loan, was waiting for him.
The NBC cameraman didn't have his sound recorder on when he captured this traumatic moment. The shot NBC viewers heard was added from a sound effects record by editors back in New York. They wanted to hype the drama of the scene. New York editors also removed an explanation by Howard Tuckner because his closing was considered anticlimactic. The violent image was asked to speak for itself. By the way, we would have shown you the actual story, but American networks steadfastly refused to allow anyone else to use the faces and voices of their correspondents.
It is not often that a television cameraman, or a still cameraman, for that matter, gets on film, happening right there before your eyes, one man blowing another man's brains out. It's kind of the supreme melodrama. And I think it was regarded as a great piece of film, and the fact that it was regarded as a great piece of film tells you a lot about journalism.
It was a kind of superb piece of theater in a grotesque way. It was a kind of ultimate horror story that you captured in living color. But in terms of information, it told you almost nothing. And that's the chronic problem, especially for television and for still photos, of the difference between drama and information.
And we got near the corner of this block, and I was standing there just watching what they were doing, and all of a sudden, General Luan, who was then a colonel, he was a, and I didn't know who he was at the time, he was actually a full colonel and the chief of police for South Vietnam, the national chief of police. And I just watched him walk, you know, I was about 5 feet away from the prisoner. And I watched him, he just walked like right into the camera frame. And I seen him go for his pistol. And I thought that he was going to threaten the prisoner, which is very common, you know. And as soon as he went for his pistol, as soon as he raised his pistol, I raised the camera, took a picture. He put his pistol down, put it back in his holster, walked away and came right by us, and he said, "They killed many of my men and many of your people." They found out he was the same guy who killed one of Luan's officers, and his whole family, wiped out his whole family. You know, the picture haunts General Luan, but it also haunts me. In fact, to this day, I feel very, very, very guilty in a lot of ways because of what it's done to General Luan and to his life. But he kind of, several times he's told me himself that he said, "You were doing your job and I was doing my job." You know, so he kind of trying to help, you know, what I'm living with too, because I feel very, very responsible for everything that's happened to him.
Robert Northshield, producer-director of the Huntley-Brinkley Report, edited the Luan footage for maximum impact. He denies that political implications were intended, although he admits in retrospect that the footage had considerable impact. What insight did the footage provide?
We had it and we used it. I mean, there was just, at the time, there was no argument about there just couldn't have been any argument about it. I mean, it was a remarkable piece of film at a crazy, crazy time. And what its effect would be could not have possibly been predicted. Its effect, I assume, exists. I cannot in any way predict what that effect will be, I mustn't try to predict. That's propagandistic. That's not journalistic, by my definition.
Harry McPherson, who is a presidential counselor and speechwriter, told me, and I have a quote in my book, that he would go home and look at the news every night on television and see the media coverage, and then he'd come into Walt Rostow's Situation Room in the White House, and Rostow would say, "Hey, things are going great. We've really got them on the run. We're killing Viet Cong. Tet is a great victory." And McPherson said, "Well, this just seemed so out of phase with him that he didn't trust what Rostow was telling him." He said he didn't think he had any right not to trust him, that this intelligence probably was accurate, but it was just so much at variance to what he had seen on television the night before that he just really found it unbelievable.
And there was another feeling that I felt as I watched it. That was the feeling of an aide to President Johnson, someone who was supportive of his efforts to end the war in an honorable way. And I knew that the impact of that footage on television, on the American people, would be tremendous, that it would hit them very hard. And it gave me all the more a feeling that I should do whatever I could to help us get out as quickly as possible.
From the image that was presented to us, we simply saw a man with his arms shackled being led forward to someone who had never even seen him before, who pulled out his gun and shot him. I don't know that there was even any conversation about the fact that the man had done anything. At least that wasn't presented on the film. We simply see the head of the Saigon police, I believe he was, executing someone simply because he wanted to do it.
So we can see that at Tet, those few isolated war crimes committed by our troops and allies received banner headlines, while horrendous communist atrocities such as the Hue massacre were downplayed. Ben Wattenberg of the American Enterprise Institute has reflected on the policy implications for an open society of this persistent imbalance.
Whatever we might have done in Vietnam for what I have always thought was a decent cause, the Soviets, for an obscene cause, are doing 100 times more violence. There is a major genocide going on in Afghanistan, but we can't get our television cameras in there. The Soviets don't put their television cameras in there, obviously. So if you have no cameras, you have no horror. If you have no horror, you have no outrage. If you have no outrage, you have no story. What this means is you have changed the geopolitical balance. The geopolitical balance, the hinge of it, revolves the possibility, if pushed too far, of using force. It becomes extremely difficult for a free country, a free superpower like ourselves, to either use force or to threaten the use of force. It remains disgustingly easy for a totalitarian state to use force. We know that, they know that, they know that we know that they know it. That changes the balance of power.
Lyndon Johnson was always very sensitive to what he saw on the TV screen. As you will recall, he had a console set up in the Oval Office in which all three network news shows could be seen simultaneously. He was very sensitive to what he saw in the press. This was true from the start of the war, and it was true at Tet. We know now that Lyndon Johnson and his staff were shaken in the first week of February, right after the attacks in Vietnam on the cities by the Viet Cong. They were shaken not only by the attacks, but by their treatment on television. And so, possibly as a result, was the rest of political and journalistic Washington.
On March 31st, 1968, President Lyndon B. Johnson provided the American people with his own media event.
With American sons in the field far away, with America's future under challenge right here at home, with our hopes and the world's hopes for peace and the balance every day, I do not believe that I should devote an hour or a day of my time to any personal partisan causes or to any duties other than the awesome duties of this office, the presidency of your country. Accordingly, I shall not seek and I will not accept the nomination of my party for another term as your president.
Let's try to draw some lessons about television's Vietnam. We've stressed the dangerous dependence Americans have on picture stories for their understanding of what goes on in the world. For instance, on television, Tet was a melodramatic victory for the communists. When Walter Cronkite announced in an hour-long special that the war could not be won honorably, other opinion molders, even including the President of the United States, jumped ship. Reed Irvine notes that misleading but opinion-molding reports were not limited to the time period of Tet.
Among the very serious flaws in the PBS series was the failure to discuss the impact of the media and the bad reporting on the outcome of the war. The bad reporting of the Tet Offensive was one example of this, but there were others. For example, the misreporting of the Christmas bombing when President Nixon ordered the B-52s over Haiphong and Hanoi to bomb those cities in order to force the North Vietnamese back to the conference table. This was portrayed totally falsely as being carpet bombing. It was not. As the reporters later saw with their own eyes when they went into those cities, they saw that the bombing had been amazingly accurate with very little damage to any civilian targets. Another example was the misrepresentation of the treatment being given to our prisoners of war in communist hands. Some of the networks actually bought film from the East Germans and put it on the air showing our prisoners being well-treated and in good shape when actually they were being horribly tortured and mistreated.
We asked some of our experts to distill the most important lesson about media in Vietnam which emerges from Tet.
What people in the media, particularly television, should learn from Vietnam, looking back, is that official statements from the United States government are just as likely to be true and accurate as they are to be exaggerated or occasionally false. And the notion that everything that comes out of official Washington, it must be a lie or a distortion, has now been clearly disproved by the experience of Vietnam, particularly by the experience of Tet, where practically everything the official spokesman said was right and practically everything their critics said was wrong. What the public should learn is to adopt a healthy, an attitude of healthy skepticism toward what is shown on television, particularly melodramatic imagery coming out of wars or crises, that one needs a context in which to place such images, otherwise one is in danger of having one's emotions swayed in the wrong direction.
That we have to restrain our penchant for the instantaneous. Somehow it seems that the Western press in particular, and American press also, has this particular liking for the immediate, without having time to look into the background of it or look at the broad pictures.
I think it's sort of like covering volcanoes. When they erupt, you can't get near them, they're too dangerous. And before they erupt, you can't see what's going on because all the action is underground. Well, you have to have people then who are volcanologists. And the media doesn't have this, or did not have this in Vietnam.
You cannot send people in to cover a very complicated situation unless they have some fundamental knowledge of the situation. There were too many people who came in for quick tours, particularly in television, a six-month tour, who never had the time, with the best will in the world, to read and learn anything about Vietnam, about communism, or about guerrilla warfare, which was sort of the nugget, the kernel of what they were trying to cover.
Disinformation played a key role in our defeat in Vietnam, regardless of what media stars tell you today, that they were just messengers of bad news. That happens to be twaddle in all its unrationed splendor.
The real new weapon of war is the way that television camera plays in our living rooms in a democracy, and it's a tough story to absorb, but a very important one.
Whatever the lessons we draw about the reporting of Vietnam, we still need to come to grips with the war's tragic denouement. The evacuation of Saigon, a flight which became symbolic of our defeat, took place 10 years ago. Using hindsight, we must face up to the fact that we abandoned the people of Indochina to a sad fate.
In 1983, at a conference on Vietnam in retrospect at the University of Southern California, a British journalist named Philip Knightley gave a speech in which he said that perhaps it was true that the press, the media, would have to take the responsibility for having brought about this debacle or contributed to the debacle in Southeast Asia, he said, to the abdication of a president, to the frustration of our policies, to the terrible things that had happened in South Vietnam, the misery, the deaths that had been inflicted on the people. And he said, all that may be true, but if so, so be it, because it's a small price to pay for maintenance of complete freedom of the press. Now, Mr. Knightley, in making that statement, was putting freedom of the press above all other values, above, indeed, the preservation of life itself, not to mention the other freedoms that people prize and respect.
Obviously, Mr. Knightley defends an adversary press, not one which is both free and responsible. His statement was a prescription for disaster in Vietnam. It will be a prescription for failure in the future. The media, especially television news, have become a political force in American life as powerful as the governing institutions created by the founding fathers. Unfortunately, we have no Federalist Papers to identify what checks and balances we need there. Back when the Republic was formed, Thomas Jefferson warned us, eternal vigilance is the price of liberty.
When I say indirect warfare, how many journalists do you know? I certainly don't know any media stars, or mediocrats, I suppose George Orwell would have called them, the new aristocrats, who have even bothered to read Sun Tzu on the Art of War, which was written 25 centuries ago, and it which is still fundamental to the way the Soviet Union and its proxies conduct themselves around the world. And the key quotation in that little book, which takes 2 hours to read, so it doesn't require much homework, is that the supreme excellence in war is not to win 100 victories on 100 different battlefields. The supreme excellence in war is to subdue the armies of your enemies without ever having to fight them. What we seem to relate to in this country today is thousands of warplanes, thousands of tanks, so many divisions on the Central European Front, 2 divisions in Korea, etc. This is not the name of the game.
Nous avons préparé l'offensive du Tet dès 1966.
We had been preparing for the Tet offensive since 1966. To create pressure and to help the anti-war movement in the United States.
Donc, il faut faire un coup qui pousse l'opinion publique.
We needed to deliver a dramatic blow so that the public opinion in the world and in the United States would turn against the American government. In fact, every time one prepares a battle, one should combine political and military elements. We call that the tactic of fighting and negotiation. Negotiating and fighting.
The key to everything we've been discussing is indeed disinformation, what the Soviets call disinformatia. And it's just amazing how many media stars in this country today still refuse to face up to the fact that they have been victims of disinformation over and over and over again. Some people suggest, of course, that there should be some sort of censorship, which is ludicrous. What we need is not less information, it's more information about all matters relating to indirect warfare as conducted by our self-avowed adversaries. And no amount of pious pleas for arms control agreements or quick fixes at summit meetings can detract from the fact that our self-avowed enemies, and you can check this with any defector from any Eastern Secret Service, our self-avowed enemies consider themselves in a permanent state of war against Western democracies.
I've been part of this image empire since I first appeared on television in 1948. Since then, I've made over 50 motion pictures. As a performer, I'm reminded every day of the malleability of the visual image. We used to say, a picture's worth 1,000 words. Now we know a picture often needs 1,000 words to explain what it means. And while we do justice to the sacrifice of our Vietnam veterans, let's also examine the specific media lessons of Vietnam. Modern struggles involve words and images as well as weapons. This new challenge affects all of us. Leaders have to know how to communicate in a complex media environment. Responsible citizens have to become critical viewers. The press, too, has to reconsider its role as a social force, tempering its freedom with a sense of responsibility. Only by confronting this challenge can we fully pay our debt to those who died for us in Vietnam. I'm Charlton Heston.
Let me say to the Vietnam veterans gathered here today, when you returned home, you brought solace to the loved ones of those who fell. But little solace was given to you. Some of your countrymen were unable to distinguish between our native distaste for war and the stainless patriotism of those who suffered its scars. But there's been a rethinking there too. And now we can say to you, and say as a nation, thank you for your courage. Thank you for being patient with your countrymen.
This program was produced by Accuracy in Media, Incorporated, which is solely responsible for its content. Accuracy in Media gratefully acknowledges the special support of those who made this documentary possible. For more information about AIM books, newsletters, and media on media productions, write to Accuracy in Media, 1275 K Street, Northwest, Washington, D.C., 20005. Or call Accuracy in Media at 202-371-6710. Criticisms and suggestions are always welcome.